say it's hopeless, they must have never met my God. Some may say it's over, but it was finished on the cross. Some may say it's broken, but the healer's in the room. Some may say it's hopeless, but I know God's about to move. God's about to move. There's a miracle in the works. I can feel it. But he's made a highway through. Some may see a mountain, but we've seen a mountain move. Some may see a grave, but we've seen his empty tomb. Some may see a battle, but I know there's a miracle in the works. I can feel. Dry bones started shaking. All that died will live again. Oh, the miracle you're making, the beginning, not the end. Eternity is waiting to see your church alive again.
Our online service is about to start in a few minutes. Aren't you just excited?
I am very excited, Kuya Arvin, because this is the first Sunday of the month, and if you are new here today, we want to extend a very warm welcome for joining our online service. Whether you're just having a look or searching out for a place to worship, we are delighted to have you here. And also, I want to let you know that we have a welcome room for newcomers after the service. We hope that you will join us so that we can get to know you better.
Yes, we do hope to see you in our welcome room. We also want to welcome this brand new month. It's now the seventh month of the year, can you believe it? And this month, we'll have our church anniversary as well, so stay tuned for that special celebration.
Yes, and speaking of celebration, as this is the first Sunday of July, we will be celebrating the lives of our birthday celebrants and those celebrating their wedding anniversary. We are praying for all of you and God's greatest blessing upon your lives.
Yes, we send all our birthday greetings and happy anniversary to you all. So with that, I hope you're all excited and ready. Come now, let us worship our King and our Lord.
Hallelujah. Good morning, church. Arise and shine, for your light has come. And let us sing unto the Lord. Amen. Come on, let's go.
Sing, and make music with the heavens. We will sing. So grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus. We sing. What's not to love about you? Heaven and earth adore you. Kings and kingdoms bow down. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one. You are the love that frees us. You are the light that leads us. Like a fire burning. Son of God, you are. We're leaving.
don't stop praising God. Woo!
Come on, church, let us give Him all the glory. Shout the name of Jesus. Give you glory for all you brought me through, and now I'm ready for whatever you wanna do. I'm moving forward to follow after you, and now I'm ready for whatever you wanna do. I'm ready for whatever you wanna do.
To the Lord this morning. Hallelujah.
Yeah. Oh. just one touch from you. I put aside all distractions, 'cause I came for you, I came for you. I need you more than ever.
Nothing else satisfies.
Nothing else satisfies.
Yeah.
All my life I surrender. I live for you. I live for you. 'Cause I came for you. I came for you. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come and move upon this place. We desire an encounter once again. Holy Jesus, take me deeper. I came for you. I came for you. 'Cause I came for you. I came for you. Have your way.
have your way in this place. And Lord, we have come for you. Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah. We give you all glory, honor, and praise. For it is yours, oh God. You alone are worthy. And so we sing glory, glory, glory in the highest. Yes, Lord. You are the first. You go before. You are the last. Lord, you're the encore. Your name's in light for all to see. The starry host declare your glory. Glory in the highest. Glory in the highest. Glory in the highest. Yeah. Apart from you, there is no God. Light of the world, the bright morning star. Your name will shine for all to see. You are the one, you are my glory. Glory in the highest. Glory in the highest.
Worship our Father in heaven. Let us worship Jesus. Let us worship the Holy Spirit. He is here in our midst this morning. Hallelujah.
Oh, oh, oh.
creating one, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Yeah, yeah. Oh. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Oh, descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Whoever seated high, yeah. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our
in our midst this morning. Oh, hallelujah, we are grateful that you are our living God. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Once again, Lord God, prepare us for your powerful and mighty and alive words, oh God. Lord, let it be so alive in our hearts, Lord, as we receive it, Lord, from our pastor. Bless him as he preached the word, your words of life. In Jesus' name we pray, and all of God's blessed people, sumigaw, shout amen and amen.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Words of Life. We're so glad that you're here with us today on this beautiful July morning. So for those of you joining us for the first time, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. Perhaps you were invited by a friend or you stumbled into our account and you're watching now. I hope that you stay until the very end because I have a powerful word that just may speak into your life and into your heart today. So stick around. For those of you that are part of the Words of Life family and who follow us faithfully week after week, we want to thank you for joining us, being with us today. And I've got some really exciting news. This is July, and that means we are officially starting the second half of 2021. Now, we don't know how long this pandemic is still going to go, but I do have some good news for you. I already announced it last week, but I want to be able to reiterate it today that we are going to be starting our in-person services. Lord willing, if everything goes according to plan and we don't suddenly shift back to MECQ or ECQ or anything like that, we plan to have our first in-person service since this pandemic started on the 18th. Of this month. That's 2 weeks. 2 weeks from today. And that really excites me because you know what? I really, really miss you guys. I miss fellowshipping with you. I miss worshiping with you. I miss preaching the word in front of a live audience as you listen. You know, all of that. And everything else that comes together with being in a live service in our place of worship in Teatrino. So on July 18, Lord willing, we're going to be there. Now, we're going to be releasing our protocols. If you haven't received it yet, you should be receiving it very, very soon. Now, please, please take the time to read the safety protocols because we have to be very strict about this for everybody's safety. Okay? Any questions that you might have, hopefully will be answered in our protocols. And if you have any other question that we did not address, please feel free to write us, call us in the office, and we will be more than happy to address your questions and hopefully lay any concerns to rest. In the meantime, we want you to know also that July 18 is our 19th church anniversary. So I think it's so fitting that we're going to be together. Now, just so you know, Teatrino is not allowing full capacity, okay? So we're going to be letting you know how many will be there, how many can come, how you can sign up for that, and we will have to stick to that number. So you'll have to be, if you really want to attend, you got to sign up as soon as we open it. You got to sign up as soon as possible because once we hit the maximum number of people allowed, we will have to close it. We will not allow walk-ins to maintain. We need to follow the rules that are set to us, okay? So I hope to see you there I will see you there, Lord willing, on the 18th, okay? I'm really excited about that. I hope you are too. Okay, now, because this is the first Sunday of the month, we also like to pray and bless all of you who are celebrating your birthdays this month and also those of you celebrating your wedding anniversary. So if that's you, you're celebrating your birthday, whether it be your biological birthday or your spiritual birthday, okay, you're welcome to join us. This month, on the 24th, is my spiritual birthday, and I will be turning 38 years old in Christ. Okay, that's almost four decades. I'm really excited about that. But anyway, let's all stand. Okay, those of you celebrating your birthdays, I'm standing together with you and we're going to pray for you. Those of that are around, if you have anybody in your home right now or wherever you might be, and you have somebody standing there because it's their birthday or wedding anniversary, why don't you go over to them and just lay hands on them, okay, as we release a blessing on them. So, let's pray. Father, we are blessed. We are truly blessed by the lives of these who are standing up right now. And so we want to thank you. And as we remember their birthdays, as we remember the day that they were born, as we remember the day that they were born again, we thank you for their lives. We thank you that you have called them into the kingdom. We thank you because every birthday is a milestone of your faithfulness, that they are still alive to celebrate another birthday. That is something so awesome. And so, Father, we pray, bless them, cause them to walk in health the next 12 months, O Lord. Let this be, regardless of how long this pandemic will still be, let this be their best year yet. We declare it over you that you will walk in the fullness of God's covenantal blessing. You will walk in His grace, His favor, His joy, His peace, His fullness, His presence above all else. And so we declare that over you. We pray that over you even now. And for those who are celebrating their wedding anniversaries, we thank you. We speak your blessing upon their marriage relationship, that they will fall in love more and more, creating beautiful memories. But more than just that, Father, we pray that their relationship will be a blessing to many others around them. That as husband and wife, as a couple, they reflect the character of you, O Lord, your character, the fullness of who you are. May that be the legacy that they have, especially for their children. And so, Father, bless them as well. Bless those who are celebrating their birthdays and their anniversaries. We give you thanks for their lives, and we bless you for the grace that is upon them. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen and amen. Well, praise God, and you may take your seats. And once again, we want to welcome everyone here on this beautiful day. And I want to get into the Word. So, having said that, let me share with you the title of my message. And then let's go back to the Lord for a short word of prayer. I entitled this, Being Christlike in a Fallen World. And I've been praying about this. I'm really excited about this word, so listen. But before we continue, let's pray. Father, I ask for your help in sharing this word. I pray, Father, that you will anoint everyone that is listening to this word. I pray that you will bless them. I pray that you will cause them to understand your word, O Lord, even now. And that you will anoint me as well so that I will speak your word in with clarity and in a way that will bring transformation. We thank you. We bless you today, Lord, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen and amen. Praise God. So, being Christ-like in a fallen world. This is really a challenge. The world is a fallen world. There are many hurt people who do things that are ungodly. How do we continue to be godly in a world that is so against holiness and godliness and everything that God stands for? That indeed is a challenge. How do we maintain our Christian identity and our Christian message to a fallen world without compromising, without being a pain to the people around us so much that we become a turnoff? How do we live how do we conduct ourselves in a world in such a way that people will want what we have, Well, that's what we're going to try and answer today. And it truly is a challenge. And there are many Christians that interpret the scriptures in certain ways that feel that they are justified for their actions, whatever that might be. Okay? So let's look into the scriptures. And let's go back a little bit in history. And we will discover, for example, in the year 587 BC, Jerusalem was attacked by the Babylonians. And by the following year, in 586 BC, Jerusalem fell and the city was destroyed. As a result, the people were brought to Babylon, and it became such a difficult time for the Jewish people. And the reason is because they always felt that God was supposed to protect them. And now they just got sacked. They got conquered by the Babylonians. So a lot of the people were crying out, "Where are you, God, in all this? How could you allow this to happen to us? You're supposed to protect us. You're supposed to protect us from our enemies. And now we got delivered into exile." In fact, this is actually the cry of the book of Habakkuk. If you take the time to read it, this is not so much a prophecy, but a lamentation of Habakkuk, wondering where God was in all this, and trying to, as God answered, trying to make sense of God's answer, because it just somehow could not compute in the mind of this prophet. Some people, while in Babylon, mounted a revolt and fought against their captors, against their oppressors. Others gave in and integrated themselves into Babylonian culture. They dressed like them, ate their foods, worshipped their gods. You'd think that these would be the only two ways to deal with the situation: fight or assimilate. But the prophet Jeremiah said that there was a third way, a way to live in a foreign land that is actually pleasing to the Lord. So turn with me to Jeremiah chapter 29, and we're going to begin with verse 4. Listen to this. "This is what the Lord Almighty says, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and settle down, plant gardens and eat what they produce, marry and have sons and daughters, find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there, do not decrease. Also, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Yes, this is what the Lord Almighty says, the God of Israel says, do not let the prophets and diviners among you deceive you. Do not listen to the dreams you encourage them to have. They are prophesying lies to you in my name. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. This is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to this place." So you will see that God now begins to reveal through the prophet Jeremiah, first of all, that this is his doing. We saw that in verse 4. This is his doing. And then, in the very next verse, Jeremiah, or the Lord through Jeremiah, tells them to settle down, marry, and seek the well-being of the land that they were in this case, Babylon. Now understand that this was neither compromise nor revolt. God was not telling them to fight their oppressors or their captors. God was not telling them to compromise either. Although in the initial reading, it seems to sound that way. But if you go a little bit further, it's not quite that way. There's a third way. You see, the Lord planned to keep Israel here in Babylon for a long time. 70 years. That's a long time. That's a whole generation. One generation. That can only mean one thing. He has a plan both for Israel and for Babylon. Now, understand. See, I said, this is not compromise. Even when he said, eat the food that they produce. This does not talk about now they're okay to eat pork, you know, if they ate pork there in Babylon, which they probably did. It doesn't mean that God suddenly said, it's okay to break the Torah and you go ahead and eat pork and eat lobsters and shrimps, all of these unclean foods. That's not what he's saying. He said, eat the food they produce. He was talking about vegetables and basically vegetables and fruits. And even the kosher food based on the law of God. When he said, for example, to marry, give your sons to marry and find husbands for your daughters and so on and so forth, does not mean that you will intermarry. Because that went against the law. It went against the Torah. And so it's among themselves. He says, while you're here, I don't want you to decrease. I want you to increase. I want you to thrive where you are. And this is one of them, I believe, the messages of God, that wherever you are, no matter what your situation is, it is God's desire. Listen, it is God's desire for you to prosper where you are. Some of you perhaps are Filipinos living in other countries. Well, guess what? God wants you to prosper there. Some of you, many of you are Filipinos living in the Philippines. Well, guess what? God wants you to prosper here. And it doesn't matter whether you live in Metro Manila, you live in one of the provinces, you live in a metropolitan city, or you live in a rural area. It doesn't matter. God is the God of the mountains and He's the God of the valleys. And He's the God of the good days and He's the God of the bad days. God wants you to prosper where you are. Amen. I declare that over you, to prosper in the name of Jesus Christ. Now here, when God said to marry, clearly He did not mean to marry, to intermarry, where the Jewish people will marry the Babylonians. No, that goes against the Torah. And for us today, that means we are not to intermarry, meaning to say Christians marrying non-Christians. 2 Corinthians chapter 6. That is forbidden by God. This is not a divine suggestion. And every time I bring that up, I really do my best to try and emphasize that, because I know that there are some of you right now, you've got boyfriends or girlfriends, or maybe even fiancés that are unbelievers. Let me tell you something. That is not God's will. Doesn't matter how you feel, doesn't matter how nice the person is, and they may be nice. I'm not judging them. What I am saying is, God said, you are not to be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Now here's the thing. Back to our story. There were some Jewish people that intermarried with the Babylonians. And you know what happened? The Lord rebuked them through the prophet Hosea. In fact, He sent Hosea, and that was one of the, Haggai. The prophet Haggai, He sent the prophet Haggai precisely to rebuke and correct the people because they intermarried with the Babylonians. But how then are we to live? What is it that God is saying? Well, you will discover that the book of Daniel reveals how this quote-unquote assimilation was to be done. Daniel, as you might know, also was in exile together with his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, and they became part of the Babylonian government. They were all exiles together with the rest of Israel. Now Daniel and his three friends dressed like the Babylonians. They even took on Babylonian names. Daniel, you may recall, was called Belteshazzar, and his three friends, well, they were called Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, right? Or as you probably know it in a more English translation, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And through them, we will see what this third way, where it's not compromise, but it's also not revolt. How do we find a third way? How did the people of God live among the Babylonians? Daniel and his friends were still called to critique and confront the ungodly ways of the Babylonians, but not in a violent way. They were to be faithful to God and the Torah while living in Babylon. In this way, they were not called to compromise. Why? They obeyed the Torah while they were in a foreign land. And for the most part, this should not be difficult. But you see, the problem was that as the Jewish people obeyed God and perhaps the majority remained faithful to God while in captivity, God started to bless them. And to the point where they prospered beyond their Babylonian peers. And this made the Babylonians extremely envious of them. So one day, something happened. King Nebuchadnezzar had a giant image of himself erected. And they said that every time you hear a certain kind of music, their own praise and worship, all the people were to stop whatever it is that they were doing and to bow down and worship this idol, this image of Nebuchadnezzar. But Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, well, they refused to comply. And for their rebellion, at least that's how it was construed, they were just following the Torah, the second commandment, which is not to worship idols. And so they were being faithful to God, but they were being rebellious to Babylonian law. Now, they did not revolt. They simply just did not comply. And for their non-compliance, for their rebellion, they were, well, thrown into a fiery furnace. However, because of their faithfulness to God, the Lord delivered them from their ordeal. Now, you will also recall that Daniel faced a similar situation. You see, the favor that came upon Daniel was such that he became among the dozens of governors in Babylon. He was appointed to be the head of the governors. And the jealous Babylonians did not like that. And so, I mean, the other Babylonian governors did not like that a foreigner was the one telling them what to do and leading them. Because that's how Daniel lived his life, with such integrity that even in a foreign land, he was promoted beyond the locals. Well, guess what? God wants to do the same thing for you. Amen? But back to the story. So these jealous Babylonian governors set a trap for Daniel. And in fact, in Daniel chapter 6, this is what these men, this jealous governor said. Finally, these men said, "We will never," I love that, "we will never find any basis for charges against this man Daniel." Now, let's just stop there for a while. Can you imagine that they looked for any kind of wrongdoing, corruption, any shortcut that this man, this Daniel, might have done, anything that might be against Babylonian political law? And they said, "We will never find any basis for charges against this man, Daniel, unless it has something to do with the law of his God." That means we're going to have to look for a law that we have that goes against the law that his God has. And if we can find that and enforce that, then he will not be able to comply. Then we have him. So, since there was no law, they tricked the king to enacting a rule or a law that would incriminate Daniel. And they said that all prayers must be addressed to the king for the next 30 days. And so the king liked it. He enacted it. But Daniel did not comply. He's not going to pray to another human being, whether on earth or in heaven. He will only pray to God, because that's what the Bible says. That's what the Torah taught, that they are to pray only to God, worship only God. So for this rebellion, he was thrown into the lion's den. And again, because of Daniel's faithfulness, the Lord delivered Daniel. And this is what Jeremiah was talking about. The third way. They are to pray for the welfare of the land. They are to pray that God will bless Babylon. And yet, be subversive against any law that went against the law of God. But in their subversion, in their quote-unquote rebellion, they were to do it in a gentle and submissive, non-violent way. So on one hand, they assimilated themselves, but not completely. And on the other hand, they were still exiles, trusting that God would take care of them when they needed to make a stand. In other words, they never compromised. They lived with the people, but they never compromised their witness as God's people. As a matter of fact, the Lord promised to prosper Israel if Israel obeyed the Lord. Look at Jeremiah 29. Let's go back to the text, starting with verse 11. Let's continue. "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile." So what was God saying? It may not seem to make sense to assimilate and dwell with the Babylonians, but this is where God said he would prosper them for now. Pray for the leaders of that land. Pray for the economy. Pray for the agriculture. Pray for the nation of Babylon. Because you're going to be here for 70 years, what he's saying. You're going to be here for a whole generation. This is a long time. You will be here. And if you pray against the country, it will affect you. So pray that it goes well for Babylon. And as Babylon prospers, so shall you prosper. Pray for the prosperity of Babylon. In other words, God was saying, be a blessing where you are. And I believe this is God's word for us as well. Be a blessing where you are. You might be in a home where maybe you're the only Christian. Be a blessing to your family. Bless them. Be a blessing to them. Serve them. Maybe you're the only Christian in your office, in your job, in your business. Be a blessing to the people around you. Amen? That's what God is saying. Be a blessing. You don't have to be like them, especially in their ungodly ways, but bless them anyway. And perhaps this may be the reason why Jeremiah was not a very popular prophet. What is this Jeremiah saying that we're going to stay for 70 years? The other prophets were saying that we'll be here maximum 2-3 years. And then God will deliver us. And Jeremiah said, no, don't listen to them. They're lying. God is saying 70 years. So take roots. Bless the people here. Get married. Eat the produce of the land. Settle down. Build homes. Because you're going to be here for quite some time, is what he's saying. And bless the people. Now, the people didn't like that. But for those who will obey, because this is the word of the Lord, those who will obey, God gave 7 promises. Here they are. First, I will prosper you. Second, I will not harm you. Third, you will have a future. That means this is not the end yet for you. Fourth, when you call, when you pray, I will answer. Fifth, when you seek me, you will find me. Sixth, I will deliver you from captivity. That means there's an expiration date to your stay here. And seventh, I will bring you back to the promised land. That means you're not just leaving, I'm sending you somewhere, and it's going to be a good place. Now, why did God deliver Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Well, because they were faithful. They feared the Lord. They made a stand for what they believed in without being obnoxious, without being a bad person. They didn't compromise themselves when their lives were at stake, even if the penalty of making their stand was death. They made their stand, but in a godly way, in a respectful way. They remained faithful to God no matter what the consequences would be. And eventually, Babylon fell. But there were other empires that took their place. The Medes came, the Persians came, the Greeks came, and eventually the Romans came. And in every empire, Israel was still called to be both loyal citizens, but gently subversive when called for. When Jesus finally put on flesh, the ruling empire was Rome. And just like during the Babylonian captivity, there were those who rebelled against Rome and revolted against Rome, while others assimilated through compromise. But Jesus, if you study his ways, Jesus continued that subversive loyalty that Jeremiah spoke of. For example, he said to give to Caesar what belonged to Caesar. In other words, go ahead and pay taxes to Rome. But make sure your loyalty belongs to God alone. He didn't hesitate to help Roman centurions and Roman citizens, even called a tax collector to follow him. And yet, he still called out the wickedness of the Jewish religious leaders and the Roman government officials. So do you see how Jesus lived his life? He didn't call us to be troublemakers. But we mustn't also hesitate to stand up for what is truth and justice. In Micah chapter 6, verse 8, it says, he has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? Listen, to act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. 3 things that the Lord requires of his people. And that includes you and me. First is to act justly. This means to act as a judge and do what is right according to God's word. It means to do that which is fitting and proper, the right thing. Not what we think is right, but what God says is right. It means to live according to God's laws. It means to treat people equitably or fairly, regardless of race, social status, financial standing, or even religion. We are to act justly. Second, we are called to love mercy. What is mercy? God's mercy is shown by withholding something that we deserve. Now that might sound like it's bad. But see, here's the thing. You and I, because of our sins, we deserve death. For the wages of sin is death. So we deserve death because of our sins. And it is to this walk of mercy that we are called to exhibit. Because you see, if we simply acted justly, then everyone deserves to die. Everyone deserves wrath. Everyone deserves bad things. But we are called to love mercy, to withhold that which others rightly deserve. That means to express forgiveness instead of vengeance. Do you understand? See, people might do things wrong to you, and maybe they deserve your anger. Rightfully so. But God says, I want you to love mercy instead. And show mercy instead of simply repaying evil for evil. It means to love one's enemies. And go one more step. Don't just love them, bless them. Even when they curse you. That's what it means to love mercy. It means going the second mile when you are commanded to walk one with them. It means offering your other cheek, overlooking an offense, forgiving not just once, not just twice, 70 times seven times. That's what it means to love mercy. And third is to walk humbly with your God. This is the basis for the first two. You will not be able to act justly and to love mercy unless you walk humbly with your God. It means agreeing with God on His standard and definition of good and evil. Doesn't matter what you and I think is good or evil. What does God think? What does God say? What is revealed in His Word that God expects of us? Instead of being pressured by society or pop culture. See, Abraham was called to walk blamelessly before God. Not sinlessly, not perfectly, blamelessly. And it is to this walk that God calls you and me as well. But because Jesus walked this way, the third way, not by becoming like everyone else, but not also by revolting against the prevailing empire. It provoked both the Jews and the Romans to crucify him. The Jewish people, they hated the Romans. And they wanted the Romans out. And they hoped that this Messiah would be the one to deliver them. And his non-violent ways, he said, put down the sword. This is not the time for the sword. And they didn't like that. And so at some point, they just, let's get rid of this guy. Except when Jesus was delivered to the Romans to be whipped and crowned with thorns and eventually crucified on a cross. Unlike Daniel and his friends Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, God did not deliver Jesus from his oppressors. He didn't suddenly just magically float down off the cross and down and say, I am God. He died on the cross. However, God did deliver him, vindicate him through his resurrection, proving that he is indeed king and will one day set up his kingdom, his earthly kingdom here on earth physically. Now it's here spiritually through you and me. One day, he will come as king. When he returns to earth, he will come as king and he will destroy and deliver us from all the enemies of the gospel. But until then, you and I, We are called to be faithful in the midst of faithlessness, to be governed by God's definition of goodness and evil, in the midst of promiscuity and licentiousness. And that's why Peter, in his epistle, called us foreigners living here. We are sojourners. We are exiles here on earth. And that somehow we are still living in Babylon. You see, you might say, wait a minute. Babylon doesn't even exist anymore. Well, you see, there is a spiritual Babylon. Spiritual Babylon is any human institution that demands allegiance to its idolatrous definitions of good and evil. We live in a Babylon right now. And they are telling us this is what is right, and what the Bible says, that's wrong. And they call us to bow down, and we can't. We can't bow down to any other god. The Bible calls this harlot of Babylon riding on a dragon. You find that in the book of Revelation. And one day, Babylon, the spiritual Babylon, will be judged again. So even today, a tension exists between living peacefully among the people in the land and yet being gently but undeniably subversive when the laws of God are being transgressed. The true expressions of this lifestyle that we are called to live isn't always easy to define. Sometimes the lines blur. Often, perhaps, they may blur. And we call them gray areas. Still, Jesus put it this way in Matthew chapter 10. Behold, I send you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. Therefore, be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Let me read that again. I want you to really take this in. He said, behold, I, Jesus, send you, his followers, his believers, out as sheep. We're not supposed to be wolves. We're not called to be the aggressive ones. Send you out as sheep in the midst of wolves and in the midst of the aggressive ones. Therefore, because you are sheep in the midst of wolves, therefore be wise. Be wise as serpents, but also be harmless as doves. Now, how do we do this? There's only one way. We need to walk humbly before our God. So what's my bottom line here? Here's the bottom line. First, we are called to live peacefully among the people, harmless as doves. See, the people of God didn't try to change the laws of the land. They didn't do that. Daniel didn't try to change the law against praying, but he prayed anyway. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego didn't try to change the law against idolatry, but they still didn't worship idols. Jesus, he didn't try to change Roman taxation laws. In fact, he said, go ahead, give to Caesar what belongs to him. But don't forget to give God what also belongs to him. Second, we are not to adopt their ways. We belong, remember, church, we belong to another kingdom. We are citizens of heaven. Our names are written in the book of life. We are to witness of the good news of Jesus Christ here on earth, wise as serpents, harmless as doves, sent out as sheep amidst wolves. Third, we call out sin when confronted. We speak truth, yes, but in mercy. We speak truth with gentleness and respect. That's even what Peter said in 2 Peter. He said, be ready to make a defense of the things that you believe in when people ask. But do it in gentleness and respect. See, the goal of making a defense of what we believe in and speaking truth in mercy is not to simply say, you're wrong and we're right, but to win them over to what is right and not to leave them in what is error, in what is sin, in what is wrong, in what is evil. But to say that there is a better way to live life. And we don't do that by raising a fist. We do that by offering bread instead and say, come, eat with me. We're not called to turn them off unnecessarily. Fourth, we are called to love and bless our enemies. And fifth, Jesus put it this way, we are in this world, but not of it. How are we to live as Christ-like as we can in a fallen world? Walk humbly before God. Have an ear that's constantly leaning towards Him and saying, Lord, how do I deal with this? My boss is being contentious. My boss is blaming me for something I did not do. How do I respond to this? What is the godly response to this? My subordinates are rebelling and taking shortcuts and stealing from the office. How do I handle this situation in a Christ-like way? My parents, my children, my spouse are behaving in a way that is not godly, in a way that is not Christ-like. How do I respond in a Christ-like way to their unchrist-like ways? The Bible tells us, for example, not to return evil for evil, but to return good for the evil that is done. How do I do that? And it's only in walking humbly with God. In other words, yes, God set some laws to guide us, but how we work that out is on a case-to-case basis. And we constantly come before God and say, help me in this. Help me in this. Instead of just fighting or compromising, there is a third way. Paul said, as much as is in your power, live at peace with all men. That's what we're called to. Live at peace with all men. Now, you know, some of you here, you might be saying, I don't even have peace within. How can I be at peace with others when I myself am troubled? Well, you know what? I'm glad you asked that question. Because the Bible says Jesus is the Prince of Peace. And if you're still listening to the sound of my voice, and if you're still with us here right now, I want you to know that there's only one reason for that. Jesus is calling you. And the fact that you're still listening here, to me, is a clear sign that you want to respond to that call because He is calling you. So my friend, why don't you surrender your life to Jesus today? Let Him be your Lord. Let Him be your King, that you might be a part of this kingdom and you might be a part of this family of God. Why don't you do that? How? Join me in this prayer. When you put your faith in Christ and confess His lordship over your life, His being the master of your life, the Bible says you will be saved. So pray with me right now. Say these words. Let it come out of your mouth. Mean it from your heart, though. And when we're done, you will be saved. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, today, I surrender my life to You. Forgive me for living my life independently of You. Forgive me for defining my own truth of what is good and what is evil. Today, I submit myself to You. Be my Lord, my God, my Savior, and my best friend. I thank You for saving me and loving me. Teach me how to love you and to serve you all the days of my life. This is my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now let me pray for you. Father, you know everyone that gave their life to you today. And I pray that you bless them. Bless them. Bless them. Bless them, O Lord. I pray, Father, that you will reveal yourself to them in a way that is so clear and unmistakable that they will know that you desire more than anything else to be intimately involved in their lives. And so, bless them again, Lord. This is my prayer for them. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Congratulations, my friend, for your giving of your life to Jesus Christ. I want you to know that this is the best decision you will ever, ever make in your life. But now that you're a child of God, you need to be discipled. And so I pray that you will get in touch with us. We have a welcome room. You'll see it at the bottom of your screen or even in the comment section. And click on that. Come to the welcome room after the service is over. And we've got some people who will be more than happy to share with you and even put you into a care group where you can be cared for and properly discipled. Amen. This is so important so that you will grow in the knowledge of God. So I want to congratulate you once again. And there are three things I'd like you to do for me. First, I want you to tell someone that you gave your life to Jesus today. It doesn't matter who it is. The person might be next to you or halfway around the globe. But I want you to tell someone that you gave your life to Jesus today. The second thing I want you to do is to let me know that you gave your life to Jesus today. Write it down here in the comment section. Just say, I gave my life to Jesus today. That way I can write down a short comment that will hopefully encourage you. And then I will pray for you once again. And all of our intercessors are going to be praying for you also. And the third thing I want you to do is join us again next Sunday. Okay? Same place, right here. Join us next Sunday. And I pray that you will consider making Words of Life your home church. Amen? Amen. God is so good. Amen. Once again, congratulations and God bless you. Now, to the rest of you, I also want to pray for you. I know many times your life, well, there are those times when it's not too difficult to live Christ-like. But there are times when compromise seems to be so tempting. And it is to you or for you that I want to pray right now. I want to pray for you that you might maintain your testimony and your witness as a follower of Christ. Close your eyes right now. Bow your heads. Let me pray for you. Father, I pray for every believer, every follower right now of you. I pray that you will help them, guide them, lead them in such a way that they will know that they can be gentle and yet make a stand for what is true. They don't have to be contentious. They don't have to be hard. They don't have to be pugnacious or anything. They can be gentle and yet make a stand. And so, Father, I pray that you give them grace, you give them wisdom, and you continue to cause them to be harmless as doves. Bless your people once again, Lord. Thank you. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen and amen and amen. Praise God. God is good. Amen. Amen he is. Okay, before I let you go, let me give you some discussion questions that you can discuss with your family and friends in your care groups after the service or during your care groups. Let me give them to you. First, how can you be a more effective witness to your family, friends, classmates, colleagues, associates, acquaintances who don't know Jesus yet? Meaning to say, is there something that you need to start or stop doing in your life that will assist you in your mission of witnessing? Okay. Second, Daniel 1:8 says, but Daniel purposed in his heart not to defile himself. Are you willing to apply this in your life? What area or areas of your life need to change so you can be more Christ-like? That's a good discussion point right there. And third, Ask the people around you. Could be your family, could be your care group. Am I gentle when I confront or correct others? Is the spirit of meekness, meaning truth with mercy, evident in my life? Amen. So, I pray for a blessed week. And as you go through these discussion questions, I pray that you might receive some insight about yourself. And more importantly, that you might live a life that is both true to God and yet gentle in front of other people, especially those who don't like you so much. Amen? Amen. So let's all stand. I want to release you with a blessing. Or lift up your hands this way. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance over you and give you peace. Shalom. The fullness of God's blessing over your life, now and for the rest of your days. I declare it done, even now. Father, I pray that you will within us raise up a conviction to walk blamelessly before you, that we might be true to your word, that we might be faithful to you, O God, and yet be harmless when confronted about our beliefs, that we might be gentle and patient in explaining why we believe what we believe, without destroying them, without making them feel that we are superior to them, but that they might see that there is a peace that we have that is foreign to them, that they might desire that peace and become one of your children as well. So Lord, bless your people that we might live that way and in the process, bring more people into your kingdom. This is my declaration for each one. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen, amen, and amen. Have a blessed week. We'll see you next Sunday. God bless you all.
And there we have it. Hallelujah. What an awesome service and blessed message we have received from God through our pastor. Praise God!
Yes, praise God. It's just so amazing when we receive a timely and refreshing word from the Lord. It's just fill our hearts with joy.
So WLCM family, before we let you go, we just have a few more announcements. We have our online prayer night gathering every Tuesdays and Fridays. Follow our Facebook page for more updates. You may also message our prayer hotline if you have any prayer requests or praise reports. We love praying for you guys.
And also, we want to remind you that we will be having a communion next week. So please do prepare your communion elements and let us all celebrate together. Thank you once again for joining our online service. And have a wonderful week ahead and stay blessed. See you all again next week. Bye.
Say it's hopeless, they must have never met my God. Some may say it's over, but it was finished on the cross. Some may say it's broken, but the healer's in the room. Some may say it's hopeless, but I know God's about to move. God's about to move. There's a miracle in the works. I can feel it. There's revival in the church. I believe. But He's made a highway through. Some may see a mountain, but we've seen a mountain move. Some may see a grave, but we've seen His empty tomb. Some may see a battle, but I know there's a miracle in the works. I can feel it. won't breathe again. Like the dry bones started shaking, all that died will live again. All the mirrors